Good day, everyone. I hope you still have some energy left for me. So I'm going to talk about hydroxychloroquine from the lab point of view today. So this is a plan we're going to follow. So hydroxychloroquine, commercialized in Belgium under the name of Plaquenil, is a synthetic derivative of the well-known quinine that was first synthesized in 1946 and introduced for the first time in clinics in 1955, so a long time ago. Since then, it has been approved for the treatment of malaria, rheumatoid arthritis, and lupus. Hydroxychloroquine has been one of the earliest and most studied potential therapy for the treatment and prophylaxis against COVID-19, principally due to its wide availability, its lower toxicity compared to chloroquine, and because it has already shown antiviral activity, especially against SARS-CoV in the 2003 pandemic. So as you can see on this slide, and as you may know, it has been quite a story between hydroxychloroquine and COVID-19. From its first proof of in vitro antiviral activity against SARS-CoV-2 in early February, till its discontinuation from all the major clinical trials in June, hydroxychloroquine has been at the heart of many scientific, media, and even political debates, as you may know, with our dear US President Donald Trump. I'm not going to go in details, you can read it on your own. So, the mechanism of action of hydroxychloroquine against SARS-CoV-2 is still not fully elucidated and remains a great field of debate in the scientific world, partly because it has mostly been based on in vitro studies, and also because depending on the cell line that was used, HCQ had shown different efficacies. But all the studies agree on two main hypotheses. The first one is an antiviral activity through interference in the endocytic pathway. And the second one is immunity modulation through prevention of the cytokine storm that Carol just showed us. So for the antiviral activity, as I just said, it's not fully elucidated, but all the literature agrees on two main mechanisms. First, by interfering with the glycosylation of angiotensin-converting enzyme 2, which is the cellular receptor of SARS-CoV-2, hydroxychloroquine prevents virus fusion with the host cell and consequently prevents the infection. Secondly, HCQ in its unprotonated form can diffuse passively across cellular membranes where it becomes protonated and trapped in the endosome and lysosomes, including the pH of these acidic compartments. This alkaline environment probably interferes with the fusion process and prevents RNA release by the viruses, thus inhibiting the growth of these intracellular pathogens. The second hypothesis is immunity modulation by hydroxychloroquine through two main mechanisms. In one end, through the interference of the endocytic pathway, hydroxychloroquine inhibits the antigen presentation of autoantigen mediated by the MCH class 2 to T cells, leading in the end to the reduction in the production of cytokines generated by T cells and by B cells. On the other end, and I'm not going to go in details there, it has been shown that hydroxychloroquine alters the toll-like receptors signaling, also leading to a reduction in the production of all those cytokines, the cytokine storm. The fact that hydroxychloroquine has been considered for the management of COVID-19 patients clearly highlights the need to better understand its pharmacokinetics parameters. However, a full understanding of these parameters has been challenging despite the numerous reported studies. What we know today is following oral administration of HCQ, its bioavailability can reach up to 80% with plasmid peak around 2-4 hours. The long, very long half-time of hydroxychloroquine, which could range from 30 to 50 days, is likely attributed to its very, very large volume of distribution and an extensive tissue uptake. Hydroxychloroquine is metabolized via CYP450 enzymes to other active compounds, which those three here are the one responsible for the extended pharmacological action and the toxicity. up to 60% of hydroxychloroquine is primarily excreted renally, including 20% as unmetabolized forms, and the 40 remaining percent are usually cleared through the liver, feces, and skin, or stored in other lean body tissues. There is one other, also the most common adverse effects of HCQ are gastrointestinal effects. The ocular and the cardiac toxicities are arguably the most concerning. Ocular adverse effects include retinopathy, corneal changes, and decreased visual activity. But these are most commonly associated with long-term use and would likely not be a principal concern with the short duration of treatment utilized for COVID-19. The most immediate life-threatening adverse effect of hydroxychloroquine is ventricular arrhythmias arising from QT interval prolongation. Unfortunately, to our knowledge, there have been no evaluation linking hydroxychloroquine exposure to cardiac toxicity. It is also important to note that although cardiac issues can arise with hydroxychloroquine monotherapy, most cardiac toxicity reported are likely in combination with other drugs like azithromycin, or those with baseline predisposing condition. There is one other sad effect reported in the instruction notice is acute hemolysis in glucose 6-phosphate deficient patients. But still today, there is no clear contraindication. So what are the facts and what do we do about it? That's what I'm going to talk right now. So a brief resume. So the G6PD deficiency is an enzymatic disorder of the body. It affects around 400 to 500 million people worldwide. Its distribution is global, but more common in areas which malaria is endemic. The mode of inheritance is linked. It's a X-linked disorder, meaning men are more commonly affected than women. Its clinical expression can range from asymptomatic to episodic hemolysis to chronic hemolysis. And this clinical expression depends on the degree of the enzyme deficiency, which in turn is determined by the characteristic of the G6PD variant. So there is five classes that I resumed here. So the two and the three are the most commonly encountered. So for the physiopathology, G6PD catalyzes the initial step in the pantose shut phosphate shunt, which main function is to protect red blood cells against oxidative injury via the production of NADPH. I'm sorry, there is a, the arrow is not in the right sense. So the oxidants are formed within red cells via reaction of hemoglobin with oxygens, and can also be produced by exogenous factors such as infection, which is the most common source, or oxidant drugs, which in this case may be hydroxychloroquine. If this oxidant accumulates in the red cells, hemoglobin and other proteins are oxidized, leading to loss of function and cell death, and eventually hemolysis. Under normal circumstances, these compounds are rapidly inactivated by glutathione in conjunction with glutathione reductase, peroxidase, which required the NADPH generated by G6PD. But in G6PD deficient cells, oxidant accumulation occurs, leading to acute hemolysis. So what about G6PD deficiency and hydroxychloroquine? It's also another controversial topic because there is, at the day I am presenting this this presentation, there is no convincing evidence claiming that hydroxychloroquine causes oxidant hemolysis in G6PD deficient patients, because the retrospective studies with G6PD deficient patients receiving hydroxychloroquine for rheumatic disease showed no evidence of hemolysis. There is only a few case reports of hemolysis in G6PD deficient patients COVID-19 with the administration of hydroxychloroquine, but also without the administration of hydroxychloroquine, because we know now that infection is one possible trigger of hemolysis in those patients. So today, the role of hydroxychloroquine in the context of hemolysis in COVID-19 patients still remains unclear. What do we do? What we do is that a rapid drop in hemoglobin in COVID-19 patients should alert physicians to test for GCSPD deficiency, especially if the patients are of African, Asian, Mediterranean, or Middle Eastern descent, with or without the administration of hydroxychloroquine. So that's why the LHB-ULB proposed the G6PD activity quantitative assess 7 days a week during that first wave.
So, hi everybody. I'm sorry for your ears, but I don't speak as well as Anne-Sophie English. So, for the next part, I will speak about therapeutic drug monitoring of HCQ and patient results. But why perform the TDM of HCQ, or in other words, is the drug a good candidate to perform a TDM? To answer it, there is 6 points to investigate. First, is there a significant between subject variability? Yes, as already explained by Anne-Sophie, the HCQ has a large distribution volume, which could be higher in several pathological conditions, a long half-life, and an impact of renal or hepatic function alterations. So, is there an acceptable PK stability? Yes, of course, without an acute exacerbation of the disease. A consistent relationship between blood concentration and efficacy or toxicity? Yes. A narrow therapeutic range? Yes, because the target range is between 0.7 and 1.5 mg per liter. The lower limit is obtained from an in vitro study of Yao et al., and the upper limit from the knowledge of the drug in the treatment of autoimmune disease. For the next point, yes, there is no readily accessible marker of efficacy, which would represent a preferable alternative to TDM. And is there a sufficient treatment duration? I think no, because the overall treatment duration was of 5 days. So, in conclusion, the HCQ is a good candidate to perform a TDM, especially in patients with severe COVID-19 illness. But on March, a more important question was, is there a clinical need to perform a TDM? Absolutely, because no blood level data in COVID-19 patients were available at this time to confirm if standard regimen obtained from in vitro data was adequate or not. Therefore, we decided to validate in emergency a HCQ assay to support our infectiologists. So the TDM method, very briefly, the method to quantify the HCQ was performed on Agilent LC-MSMS system with 200 microliters of whole blood because drug distributes extensively into erythrocytes. The analytical range obtained with an acceptable imprecision and inaccuracy were in agreement with the therapeutic target. Now, I show you the TDM results in our institution. The TDM was performed on flu samples on 66 hospitalized patients with COVID-19 pneumonia from March until May 2020. The HCQ therapy was administered according to the Belgian National Protocol guidance. In the table are presented the patient's characteristics. The mean age was 65 years, and each patient had at least one comorbidity. Now, I show you the graphic with the frequency distribution of our TDM results. As expected, we observed a wide inter-individual subject variability for the same posology. There is also a high proportion of patients with infratherapeutic levels, and 6 patients had blood levels above the upper limit of the range, but without signs of toxicity or relation with the renal function. For the GCSPD deficiency, only 6 patients were screened. One was deficient and had hemolysis. Interestingly, our local results are consistent with the literature, with the sparse data available on TDM. A PK population study on COVID-19 patients published in August has confirmed that most of the HEQ regimens used are suboptimal for an efficacy. For example, with the Belgian regimen, 66% of patients didn't achieve a target concentration. The figure is the simulation of HEQ blood concentrations for representative patients with most of the standard doses used. None except one are rapidly effective to reach therapeutic concentrations. Fortunately, this regimen was used by the WHO Solidarity Trial. Moreover, a study from Garcia Cremades et al. Has concluded that higher regimens could be safely administered without cardiac toxicity. Therefore, my opinion is that the evaluation of effective regimens could be done in consultation with labs to develop a TDM of the drug, to explore if the blood concentrations are adequate or not. Now, the big debatable question, is HCQ an effective therapy or not? On the left, I show you a huge French meta-analysis study performed on 38,000 patients. The results show that HCQ alone was not associated with reduced mortality in COVID-19 patients. This observation was shared by a large majority of studies. In contrast, on the right, it's a Belgian study including 8,000 patients and showing that HCQ alone was independently associated with a decreased risk of in-hospital mortality. This observation is quite discrepant with other studies, but in conclusion, the effectiveness of HCQ seems to stay debatable. But the Belgian study has two weaknesses. It was an observational trial, and the patients included were not with a severe COVID-19 disease. Moreover, recent data obtained on macaque and on the reconstituted human hairway epithelium also suggest that HCQ has no antiviral efficacy. And the results of the apparent effectiveness of HCQ are concordant with a pre-proof study showing that a low-dose regimen could at least be effective by an immune pathway. Indeed, the author didn't observe an effect on mortality, but they found that an early use of HCQ is associated with a decreased risk of 53% of transfer to the intensive care unit. In conclusion, the benefit seems to be mediated only by immunomodulatory properties and not by antiviral efficacy. And finally, on Thursday 5th, in October, we have the answer. The interim results of the WHO Solidarity Trial were available. About 2,000 patients were included in the HCQ arm, and the study has definitely excluded an antiviral activity. But a little remark could be done. No TDM results were available to really confirm the effectiveness of the regimen's use. So, in conclusion, the TDM of HCQ is recommended because of its particular PK characteristics. The JCPD deficiency could lead to hemolysis due to COVID-19 or HCQ therapy or both. The effectiveness of HCQ therapy is no longer a debate with the release of the interim results of the WHO Solidarity Trial. HCQ has no antiviral properties. However, the drug seems to have a clinical efficacy mainly mediated through immunomodulatory mechanism and allowing to significantly reduce the ICU admission of COVID-19 patients. But currently, the dexamethasone is a better option to prevent the cytokinic storm. In summary, in the fight against the COVID-19, I think the HCQ story is over. Thanks for your attention, and I would like to thank a few people, and in particular Guillaume Depré for his investment in the project. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Anne-Sophie, for this really nice and complete presentation about hydroxychloroquine. So. Has anyone any question? So I have something in the chat. Is hydroxychloroquine useful in autoimmune diseases? Would you recommend GCSPD deficiency screening?
Would you recommend GCSPD
screening?
Yes.
Yes, but not just for the hydroxychloroquine therapy, but just because we know that COVID-19 can lead to hemolysis in those patients, because infection is the most common triggers of hemolysis in GCSPD patients. So it would benefit everyone to know the status of the patients before or at least at admission to be prepared in case of acute hemolysis. So yes, I think it's good to know.
And the other question?
Is the actual treatment, the current treatment, excluding the hydroxychloroquine, or can they be combined? 33% of admission in the ICU is not nothing.
Dexamethasone is now a better option because it's safer, it's widely available, and we have more proof now that it's secure and efficient. So I think really hydroxychloroquine is dead and we should maintain it buried.
Okay, thank you.